Next week we'll be getting back to our series through Philippians, but today we're going to be considering Psalm 133. Now, just a little bit of background. The city of Jerusalem, for those of you who haven't traveled to Israel, is built onto the side of a big mountain, a mountain called Mount Zion. And all around this mountain you'll find plains, so Israel is pretty flat otherwise. I'm told that wherever you are in Israel, you can lift your eyes up and see this mountain in the distance. Jerusalem's not only the city of David, it was the city of the Lord. The Ark of the Covenant resided there, even in David's day. And every year, men and women from all over Israel would take this pilgrimage to go to the city and to worship their God. Most scholars agree that the Psalms of Ascent, one of the ones that we're studying here this morning, was sung by these pilgrims as they ascended up the side of Mount Zion and arrived in Jerusalem. There are 15 songs. They begin at Psalm 123 to Psalm 134, so we're towards the end of them, and they move between mourning and lament all the way through to blessing and peace. And they've been collated together in this particular order as an appropriate progression and preparation of the hearts of the saints as they come to the worship of their God in Mount Zion. So with that as some background to this psalm, let's read Psalm 133. Behold how good and pleasant it is when brothers dwell in unity. It is like the precious oil on the head running down on the beard. On the beard of Aaron, running down on the collar of his robes. It is like the dew of Hermon, which falls on the mountains of Zion. For there the Lord has commanded the blessing, life forevermore. And then if you leave a bookmark in that place and turn over to Ephesians chapter 4, some background readings which will help us understand this psalm. Ephesians chapter 4. We'll be reading the first 16 verses, talking again of unity in the body of Christ. I, therefore, a prisoner for the Lord, this is Paul talking to the church at Ephesus, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to the one hope that belongs to your call, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. But grace was given to each one of us according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore it says, when he ascended on high, he led a host of captives and he gave gifts to men. In saying he ascended, what does it mean but that he also descended into the lower regions, the earth? He who descended is the one who also ascended far above all the heavens, that he might fill all things. And he gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the shepherds, and teachers to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ, until we all attain to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to mature manhood, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, so that we may no longer be children tossed to and fro by the waves and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by human cunning, by craftiness and deceitful schemes. Rather, speaking the truth in love, we are to grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and held together by every joint with which it is equipped, with each part is working properly, when each part is working properly, makes the body grow so that it builds itself up in love. So far the reading there, and then over to the book of Hebrews, the final reading for this morning. Hebrews chapter 12, and again, understanding some of the biblical background and import of what we're studying in Psalm 133, we'll be reading Hebrews 12, verse 18 through to verse 29. 18 through to verse 29. For you have not come to what may be touched, a blazing fire and darkness and gloom and a tempest, and the sound of a trumpet and a voice whose words made the hearers beg that no further messages be spoken to them. Now, just a statement about the book of Hebrews. The author here, we're not certain that it's Paul, but the author to the Hebrews writes to Jewish Christians who fear for their well-being as a result of persecution from both the Jews and also the Roman powers around them. They have now lost their old home among the Jewish people because they have accepted Christ as their Savior. So the Jews want nothing to do with them. And so they're fearful and they're thinking of returning to that. And so the author to the Hebrews is writing to encourage them, essentially. And he says, you've not come to this blazing fire and the sound of a trumpet, which is Mount Sinai. And then he continues. For they, in verse 20, could not endure the order that was given. If even a beast touches the mountain, it shall be stoned. Indeed, so terrifying was the sight that Moses said, I tremble with fear. But you have come to Mount Zion, and to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to innumerable angels in festal gathering, and to the assembly of the firstborn who are enrolled in heaven, and to God, the judge of all, and to the spirits of the righteous made perfect, and to Jesus, the mediator of a new covenant, and to the sprinkled blood that speaks a better word than the blood of Abel. See that you do not refuse him who is speaking. For if they did not escape when they refused him who warned them on earth, much less will we escape if we reject him who warns from heaven. At that time his voice shook the earth, but now he has promised, yet once more I will shake not only the earth, but also the heavens. This phrase, yet once more, indicates the removal of things that are shaken, that is, things that have been made, in order that the things that cannot be shaken may remain. Therefore, let us be grateful for receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken. And thus let us offer to God acceptable worship with reverence and awe, for our God is a consuming fire. So far the reading of God's holy word. I'll be referring to the second and third passages, the Ephesians and Hebrews one, later on in the sermon. But our text is Psalm 133. So we'll work our way through that. The Jews of David's time were one nation under God, and yet they were made out of 12 different tribes with different histories, and at least with some of them different roles under God. The Levites had one role, the tribe of Judah had a different role. They were leaders and so on. But fast forward 3,000 years and we find that the Center for the Study of Global Christianity reporting that there are now over 45,000 distinct groups that declare themselves to be under Christ. Now, sadly, what David professes in this psalm to be the unifying factor which brings the nation of Israel together does not seem to be true of the so-called modern church. And even in churches that we might feel more at home with in terms of their doctrine, it's seldom that we experience an ache after the true Christian fellowship that David talks about within this psalm. Instead, it's common that Christians tend to be satisfied with their separation. They're relaxed about reconciliation and they're casual about concord. And I put it to you this morning that the modern church desperately needs to learn the lessons from Psalm 133, and to regain the attitude of the Old Testament pilgrims on their way to Jerusalem. The theme of this passage is essentially verse 1. It is good and pleasant when brothers dwell together in unity. It's a central thought here. We'll look first at that declaration and then two illustrations which David uses to build the strength of that illustration in verses 2 and 3. So firstly, the declaration. The psalm begins with, behold, sit up and take notice. And what does he want us to take notice of? How good and how pleasant it is for brothers to dwell together in unity. Not only good, but pleasant. God is good. And when his character, in this case, his unity among the members of the Trinity, is reflected in his people, that is good. And it's not only good because it's something to be delighted in. We delight in it because, not only because God tells us to delight in it, but because we recognize that this kind of unity is actually good. It's for our good. And perhaps the most common reason we recognize the value of this unity is because we recognize the pain of disunity. And none of us are unfamiliar with disunity in our families and or the church. In fact, one of the most certain facts about both families and churches is that every single person in them is utterly depraved. There was once an ad on TV for some painkillers, and at the beginning of this ad, the narrator says, "Do you suffer from arthritis?" And then there was this close-up of a bone that was the end of a bone that was rolling through a pile of a shard of glass. And there was this flashing red fade in this ad, and then there was this elderly person who was cringing in pain as this bone was rolling through these shards of glass. I still remember it was when I was watching TV in my childhood. But when it comes to our relationships with each other, sin is like that glass. And any activity that we attempt as the body of Christ, as we attempt to make use of this unity and common purpose, causes our bones to rub against each other in these joints. And where there's arthritis, there's pain. You see, the glass isn't supposed to be there, but it is there, and it hurts. And David certainly understood this. He experienced firsthand the pains of a broken family and nation. The 12 tribes of Israel had been divided not only because of Saul and his household, but because of David's own family problems and the sin in his own life. For those of you who are unfamiliar with the story, David committed adultery with Bathsheba, another man's wife, and then he ended up going on to murder her husband. And one of David's sons, Amnon, raped one of his daughters, Tamar, a terrible, terrible tragedy. And another one of his sons, Absalom, plotted revenge and ended up murdering his brother. Later on, Absalom also plotted to overthrow David himself, and David was forced to flee Jerusalem, and Israel once more descended into civil war. David knows probably better than most of us the turbulent nature of our relationships, the turbulent nature of relationships among God's people. And yet in this psalm, he celebrates brotherly unity as good and pleasant. The Israelites who placed it in this grouping in Scripture as the Psalms of Ascent also understood this truth. Members from all tribes would sing it as they traveled towards Mount Zion to worship their God together. The unity envisioned here in the Psalm is ultimately for all of God's people, the 12 tribes united under God's anointed King and focused on one primary activity, the worship of the Lord. David delights in this. He calls it good. He calls it pleasant. But that raises the question, do you delight in this kind of unity? Do you find it both good and pleasant? We may be tempted to argue that we don't experience this kind of unity. Sin has tainted things too much. You may argue that this side of heaven we can neither find it nor experience it. That this unity is purely theoretical. But what's interesting here is that the pilgrims that are coming to Israel, coming to Jerusalem, came from many different tribes. And they were still sinful. They would likely have been bickering and frustrations expressed as all these people packed into Jerusalem. And yet David states that it is good and pleasant. Not because they're perfect, but because they're united as a family under God with this one singular purpose, the worship and praise and honor of God. Paul tells us in Ephesians chapter 4 that even now, after Christ, even now, we are united in the spirit of the bonds of peace. There is one body, one spirit, One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all. And even as the pilgrims sang David's words on the way to Jerusalem, looking forward to the unity of the brothers and setting that unity as a goal of theirs to express to one another as they arrived in Jerusalem, we also need this attitude to church. We must strive to grow in the unity of the faith within our families, within our church family, and also, if God allows it, with the wider church. David's words are not simply a celebration of happy families for happy families' sake. His words express an attitude which delights in corporate unity and corporate worship under God. And this speaks to the heart of our understanding of corporate worship. And many these days want to have Sunday as a family day. They fit church around it or the other activities. Now, many churches have even chose to eliminate a second worship service. Now, Lord willing, we'll be able to grow to a size and get a location where we can hold a second worship service. But the trend has been for churches that already have two to drop the second one off the bandwagon. Their parishioners seem to have other priorities. They're disinterested in God's worship. But David calls for attention here, saying, "Behold, congregation! Unity is worth aspiring to. Not the unity defined simply by mutual agreement on certain doctrinal truths, but a mutual desire to worship God together, to sing His praises together. And in light of those who traveled vast distances to Jerusalem, to ascend the holy hill of the Lord and participate in a corporate celebration of His goodness." The unity of those who fellowship in Christian communities, engaging in hospitality and being there for one another in both the highs and the lows of life, that kind of unity truly is good and pleasant. Do you really, I know brothers and sisters, you're here this morning, but consider your heart. Do you truly value the unity of God's household to that degree? Do you work towards it, seeking to reconcile with one another with urgency so that the body isn't divided? Do you ache to come to church each Sunday as often as your elders are able to facilitate it, in this case once in the morning, so you might join your voices together in unity to sing praises to your God? It's a weighty question. As if this first statement isn't convincing enough as it is to make us elevate our minds to consider the great blessing that this is, David gives us two powerful illustrations about why it's truly good and pleasant, why we should value this so highly. So firstly, the illustration verse 2, the anointed high priest. He says it's like precious oil, or literally the good oil. It's the same word as in verse 1. In the Hebrew, it's tov. The good oil. Unity is like good oil on the head, running down the beard on the beard of Aaron. Now, I was talking to Peter earlier, and he really likes the idea of an oily beard. He was trying to tell his wife how delightful it is if you get oil in your beard. I still don't really understand it. I never did when I was a young person, until I started studying this. We truly don't understand how pleasant Aaron's oily beard was until we turn to Exodus chapter 30 and we look at verses 22 to 33. If you're taking notes, you can scribble that down. We won't read the whole thing. But at that particular section in Exodus 30, God tells Moses to get the people to make this particular oil. So we aren't going to read the whole passage, but if you were interested in turning to it, I'll be talking to a couple of the verses there. And as we consider that chapter, there are at least three important things which we need to learn about this oil and the metaphor that David is using by way of comparison. Firstly, this good oil is a consecrating oil. God says explicitly in Exodus 30 verse 32, "It is holy, and it shall be holy to you. And a couple of verses earlier, he says, "You shall anoint Aaron and his sons and consecrate them, and they may serve me as priests." And so we see here that the expression of unity of purpose as God's people come to worship is that they're a holy people set apart in whom he shows special favor. We serve and worship God as those who are purified, as those who are made holy by the one who made us holy. Another thing to realize about this is that the good oil is a delight to those who participate in it and witness it. Not only was it made from the finest spices blended by the perfumer, verse 23 mentions liquid myrrh. And you don't even really need to know what these things are or smell like. It just sounds delightful. Liquid myrrh, sweet-smelling cinnamon, aromatic cane. And there's another ingredient which is similar to cinnamon there in the next verse. But not only did they use these amazing, very expensive spices to make this, but it wasn't applied to Aaron's head with skimp. I'm having a play on the word skimpy. I couldn't really think of a different one. It was very generously applied to Aaron's head. It overflowed from the crown of his head, through his beard, even under his robes. So too does the unity of brothers, to quote Spurgeon, perfume all it alights upon. And it blesses all those who both participate in it and bear witness to it. Now thirdly, the other thing to bear in mind here is that in mentioning Aaron's name in Psalm 133, there's a powerful link to his function as a high priest, anointed by God for a particular purpose. Not only is the oil delightful in itself, but the image calls to mind that God has actually anointed a high priest in order for him to act as an intercessor between him and his people, to restore that relationship. In verse 30 of Exodus, the chapter in Exodus, it says, "You shall anoint Aaron and his sons," as I read earlier. And according to David in Psalm 133, just as the establishment of the priesthood under Aaron was worth celebrating, so too the unity among brothers. The author of the Hebrews also picks up on this, as we read in before the sermon, and he noted that a greater high priest than Aaron has come. Hebrews 10 verse 19, "Therefore, brothers, since we have a confidence to enter the holy places by the blood of Jesus," and then down in verse 21, "and since we have a great high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart, in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience, and our bodies washed with pure water." The anointing of our great high priest Jesus Christ is worthy of all the praise and the celebration that we can muster. Truly, it is good and pleasant in itself. But look at one of the implications the author draws out of this truth in verse 24. "And let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near." Congregation, our unity of faith in Christ should stimulate us to draw near to one another. And if that should have been true both of the 12 tribes of Israel and the New Testament church, how much should it be true of our church here? Now, the fact that we have a great high priest who continually intercedes for us in the house of God is cause not only for joy, but for unity. That's the teaching here within the book of Hebrews. And not only is a unity in the sense that our names are written in the church roll book next to one another, but a true unity defined by our worship and praise. And that unity is expressed both in our stirring one another up to good works and in meeting together to praise our great God and King. And yet there's another illustration here in verse 3 as well, which we can draw some lessons from about the value of this unity. Second illustration is that it's like the dew to a dry mountain. And this unity among brothers is like the dew of Hermon which falls on the mountains of Zion, for there the Lord has commanded the blessing life forevermore. Again, David picks up on this falling down, the same word as running down in verse 2. And here it's the dew of Hermon which runs down or poetically falls on Mount Zion. And Mount Zion was the place of a fortress taken by David in 2 Samuel 5. Like I said earlier, it was where the city of Jerusalem was built around. Another psalm by the sons of Korah reflects on this. He says, "On the holy mount stands the city he founded. The Lord loves the gates of Zion more than all the dwelling places of Jacob. Glorious things of you are spoken, O city of God." That's Psalm 87. In Psalm 132, the psalmist also considers God's choice of dwelling place. The psalm just before ours, still a psalm of ascent. "The Lord has chosen Zion. He has desired it for his dwelling place forever." And from there, the psalmist goes on and he says, "This is my resting place forever," the words of God. "Here I will dwell, for I have desired it. I will abundantly bless her provisions. I will satisfy her poor with bread. Her priests I will clothe with salvation, and her saints will shout for joy. There I will make a horn to sprout for David. I have prepared a lamp for my anointed. His enemies I will clothe with shame, but on him his crown will shine." This is the blessing which the covenant-keeping God commands from Zion for Zion. He swore to David a sure oath at his command. Blessing overflows from God to both David and to his household as God is faithful to his covenant promise. So Mount Zion is a favored mountain, but what about Mount Hermon? And why is that mentioned here? Well, the Mount Hermon that David is most likely referring to is found in the upper Jordan Valley. It rises almost like Mount Taranaki does, from a flat plain up to 10,000 feet above the sea level. Around this mountain, it teems with swampland. And given how warm it is in the area, these humid swamps let off a huge amount of moisture. And this moisture rises each day and comes into contact with the cool sides of the mountain. And then each evening it comes back down the mountain in this heavy dew. One person who experienced this said, "It penetrated everywhere and saturated everything. The floor of our tent was soaked. Our bed was covered with it. Our guns were dripping. The dewdrops hung around everywhere. No wonder that the foot of Hermon is clad with orchards and gardens of such marvelous fertility in this land of droughts." See, Psalm 133, David is comparing the unity of the faith and worship expressed in the members of the 12 tribes inhabiting Jerusalem as they go towards Mount Zion. He's comparing all that with the life-giving dew on Mount Hermon. God-centered communities thrive when they enjoy this unity. By contrast, strife and dissension among God's people doesn't only undermine the blessings that God gives, it sterilizes the soil. Where there's no mutual love for one another, only death grows. When you hold each other at arm's length or even refuse to associate with someone else in the church simply because they're more in need of grace than you because they're more sinful, and possibly because they're behind you in some way in the levels of sanctification or Christian maturity in their life, those kinds of attitudes, those attitudes of pride, stifle life. But how good and pleasant when God's people enjoy the life which flows from out of the work of the Holy Spirit. How good and pleasant to experience and to bear witness to a people who are truly united across different cultures. Those who seek to build one another up in the service and celebration of God, to dwell with one another as a whole body, united, especially when there seems to be every reason for division. For it is in Zion that God dwells, and he has commanded blessing to flow to his people, life forevermore. in David's mind and on the lips of the pilgrims singing these praises, this phrase would call to mind God's blessing, which extends from generation to generation, and his faithfulness from everlasting to everlasting. He has promised a covenant to David and his people that he would be their God and that they would be his people. And he will keep that. He will be their growth and their blessing. He has commanded it, and it will come to pass. Brothers and sisters, as we consider the psalm and the wonder that God has given to us in the unity of the brothers in Christ, we realize that both David and the Old Testament pilgrims certainly had many reasons for celebration as they considered the blessing of unity and community. And yet, in light of Christ's coming, as we look back to Christ's coming, we have a bigger picture of how great and how wide and how deep the Father's love is for us. The struggle we have this side of heaven is that we don't still experience the true unity with our brothers that we should. Sin gets in the way. And in order for God's people to become truly unified, we needed a Savior who would remove the sin that causes division and strife. Christ Jesus needed to come to die on the cross. He needs to fully sanctify his bride so that he might present the church to himself in all splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. Congregation, through Jesus, we have become members of God's family. And not just members, but our Lord is not ashamed to call us brothers and sisters. God is not ashamed to call us his sons and his daughters. At God's command, Christ went to the cross to restore the unity of a broken household. A household not only defined by Israel's borders, but by faith. And that household is now a blended family. It not only contains Jews who recognize Christ as their coming Messiah, but also millions of Gentiles such as ourselves who have been adopted as heirs. As Christ said to the Samaritan woman in John 4, "Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when neither on this mountain, Mount Zion, or in Jerusalem will you worship the Father." Congregation, our spiritual pilgrimage is no longer to Jerusalem or Mount Zion to visit the tabernacle or the temple of God. In Christ, our sins have been laid at the foot of the cross in Jerusalem already. The penalty has been paid, the burden lifted. But now we participate in a pilgrimage here on earth as we wait to enter a heavenly Jerusalem, to ascend the holy hill of the Lord where Jesus is seated at God's right hand. His sacrifice means not only that our unity with one another is being restored here on earth, but more importantly, our ability to dwell in unity with him and our heavenly Father has been restored. That sin no longer tarnishes or taints our relationship with him. But he delights in us. God commanded and Christ obeyed. And blessings spread from the cross on Mount Zion to his people in all nations, all over the world. For us, the psalm is a reminder not only of our current blessing, but our hope-filled future. We look forward to being united once more with our older brother, Jesus Christ, when he comes again, and we will truly be able to experience how good and pleasant it is to dwell together with him, united in worship with all the saints as we praise our God on high forevermore. Amen. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for the reminder that we have that unity in you is truly worthwhile pursuing. We ask that you will continue to work in us to purify us, to make us more spotless as Christ's bride. And we ask that we will indeed be able to join with him in singing your praises in heaven as we're united as one family without sin when Christ comes. We pray these things in Christ's name for your glory. Amen. In response, let's stand if you're able and sing. Number 134, O bless our God with one accord. 134. It's a familiar tune to us. It's It's one of the, it's Old Hundredth, it's one of the benedictions.